Bien, buenas tardes a todos. Muchas gracias por venir. En primer lugar, no veo nada, pero bueno, tampoco importa. En primer lugar, quería pedir disculpas por los imponderables ponderables para Iberia que hicieron que ayer fuese imposible dar pues esta charla, ¿no? Como sabéis, Iberia perdió la maleta y en la que estaba todo el material y fue imposible que esta charla tuviese lugar. No me voy a extender apenas nada en la presentación de Dan Graham, porque es un artista que, pues bueno, seguro que todos lo conocéis, y su obra es una de las obras esenciales para entender el desarrollo del arte contemporáneo. Sin lugar a dudas, es uno de esos artistas que mejor ha sabido escapar a todas las lógicas de incursión en movimientos, en estilos. Su obra, de hecho, apenas puede ser emplazada en ninguno de los estilos que han definido el arte de la segunda mitad del siglo XX. No es una obra típicamente minimalista, ni típicamente conceptual, ni típicamente activista, ni su uso del vídeo es el habitual, ni su uso de la arquitectura o de lo escultórico-arquitectónico es el habitual, sino que responde siempre a una singularidad que hace que su obra sea difícil de encuadrar en cualquiera de esos campos, y que, sin embargo, haya entendido casi mejor que ninguno de los artistas de la segunda mitad del siglo XX cada uno de todos esos movimientos. Quizás su obra es la que mejor nos define la realidad del arte minimal, la que mejor sabe, la que mejor expresa lo que fue realmente el conceptual, lo que fue el desarrollo del videoarte, pero, como digo, sin que sea sin que pueda ser característica de ninguno de esos periodos. Los ha hecho evolucionar de ninguno de esos estilos, movimientos o maneras de ver. Los ha hecho evolucionar hasta conferirles un estatus plenamente singular. Una obra en la que, pues como digo, podemos ver resumidos e incluidos todo el desarrollo del arte de los 60 hasta nuestros días. Esto en cuanto al estilo, ¿no? que ha sabido ampliar en la manera de hacer, ¿no? Que ha sabido ampliar todos estos movimientos, llevando incluso la escultura a la casi indefinición, a eso que Rosalind Krauss llamaba la escultura en el campo expandido. Quizá tenga mejor definición que nadie en la obra de Dan Graham, ¿no? Esa disolución por completa de las fronteras entre los géneros, entre lo que es escultura, entre lo que es arquitectura, instalación, paisaje, simplemente presencia de algo que altera nuestras percepciones, que ese quizás sea el concepto esencial que rige toda la obra de Dan Graham, la alteración de la percepción, una obra que trabaja, como veremos ahora, sobre la visión, sobre la percepción y sobre la toma de conciencia de nuestro cuerpo en el espacio y de nosotros mismos como seres que se relacionan con el espacio. Y sobre todo de seres que se relacionan también con el tiempo, porque quizá este sea en última instancia el concepto esencial que rige toda su producción, la alteración de nuestra percepción del tiempo, del pasado, del presente, de la continuidad e incluso del futuro. No me voy a detener más comentando su obra, porque lo va a hacer él mejor que nosotros, mejor que yo, desde luego. Simplemente, en nombre del CENDEAC, quería darle las gracias, agradecerle que esté con nosotros hoy y comentar un poco la dinámica en la que se va a desarrollar esta tarde. En primer lugar, va a pronunciar una conferencia sobre su obra, sobre todo sobre su obra relacionada con el paisaje y relacionada con los proyectos de arquitectura escultórica, que durará aproximadamente unas 2 horas. Luego tendremos un descanso de una media hora, donde vamos a seguir escuchando una selección de grandes éxitos realizada por el propio artista. Y posteriormente vamos a ver el vídeo Rock My Religion, que es una obra donde Dan Graham presenta una particular visión de la evolución del rock and roll y de la vinculación con unos aspectos que bueno, en las lecturas oficiales no habían sido tenidos en cuenta. Una obra que se expuso en el Reina Sofía y que después ha sido, es muy difícil que se pueda ver en otro lugar, así es que va a ser una oportunidad inigualable para eso. Simplemente le cedo la palabra, nos quedamos con él y de nuevo os doy las gracias y os pido disculpas por los imponderables de ayer.
I have to say one thing about Iberia. Every time I've flown them and changed planes, they've lost the luggage. But in fact, the food was much better this time in economy class. It's better than any American Airlines food. Before the talk and during the intermission, before I show Rock My Religion, I'm featuring Dan Graham's Greatest Hits, which is a three CD set. Rock My Religion, I showed actually when I had a show at Reina Sofía, which is I think the first show they did. It was from the 80s. It features Sonic Youth, who were close friends of mine. They did two songs, and it's about Patti Smith. It might be hard to translate, but I thought it would be very enjoyable after the lecture. Actually, I'm glad I wasn't talking yesterday because I had no sleep. So now I'm in much better shape, and thanks for coming a second time. The work I'm going to show is from the last 25 years. It's work that's between art and architecture. I had a gallery. I didn't go to art school or university, but I had a gallery in 1966, 65, and 64, which gave the first show of Saul LeWitt. And my original people I knew were minimal artists. So my work has a little bit of a basis in minimal art, but it goes completely against minimal art into another area. We'll put on the first slide. It's a little bit low, isn't it? This is a work I did actually in 1976 at the Venice Biennale. There was an exhibition curated by Germano Celant called Ambiente, meaning the environment. It was in the Italian Pavilion, and it was about work that was about the overall environment. It began actually with Russian constructivist artists like Lozitsky, then Kandinsky, who did paintings on walls. Then it went into a very popular area in Italy, Art Povera, which Germano Celant was very involved with. I remember a work in the exhibition was a work by Cornelis. That had live horses eating hay as if in a stable. The work that was very important at the moment was that Count Ponza was buying was work that involved light from outside coming inside. James Turrell is doing that kind of work that was done earlier by Michael Asher and Douglas Wheeler. And I was living in Berlin on a stipendium, and I realized I had done many video pieces with time delay, and I realized to do a video piece with time delay would never work in Italy. Technically, they're not very good, but in architecture and design, they're great. So I sent them a plan for an architecture piece. It's called Two Audiences, Public Space. And the next slide. It's a rectangle divided in half, so you have two rooms. You can enter either of the two rooms, the room on the right or the room on the left. It was a little like minimal art, but it turned out to be much more about psychology, sociology, and about people in groups. There's a mirror on the right side. There's a mirror dividing the two rooms. It says thermopane. It's actually acoustopane. It's thick glass where you can hear. You can see people on the other side, but you can't hear them. And then on the room on the left is just a white wall. The audience, the piece is like minimal art. If there's just one person there, it looks like it's about the materials. But when more people come in, it becomes more psychological and social. Next slide. So people are looking at each other from either audience. Can we go backwards now on the slide? People who are on the wall with the mirror can look at themselves in the mirror, and they'll see other people in the other room, and maybe in their own room, looking at them as they look at themselves. So it's minimal art is about the object, whereas my work is about the spectator's own sense of themselves as perceivers, perceiving themselves as they're perceived by other people. In other words, Lacan's mirror stage. Although I hadn't read Lacan, I'd read Jean-Paul Sartre's Being and Nothingness, where he talks about this. I read that when I was 14. So people in the mirror room then can actually look back at people in the other room through the glass. But people in the room that has the white wall have a different situation. They'll always see themselves looking at they always look in the mirror because they'll see themselves in the mirror, and they see themselves first as a ghost reflection on the thick glass, and then actually in the mirror. But it's very different from the people in the room with the mirror, because in the room with the mirror, people can look at the room, people in the other room, and not see an image of themselves. So in fact, they can change rooms to become the other audience. This is very much about a crowd situation. I thought in Italy, people in either audience would mostly be Italians, and they'd be gesticulating like this, trying to communicate with each other with rhetorical gestures. We'll have the next slide. Okay. I also realized that the Venice Biennale is like a big world's fair. Every country has a pavilion. For instance, the English pavilion looks like a Georgian house. The Canadian pavilion, which is very next to the English pavilion, it takes place in a kind of log cabin with wood, and it's very rusticated, like a vacation land of Canada. So every country shows one artist that represents that country. So it's like a world's fair, and my work actually comes really out of a work I did for video in a shopping arcade. So what I've done is normally every pavilion is like a showcase for the product of the main artist as a product of that country. So here, instead of an object to look at or to buy, the audience, as spectators, are looking at themselves. They're in the place of the product. So it's very much about the modern city where you have show windows, except they're on display. Next slide. I realized the piece was an easy success because it had the old idea of the white cube. So I thought maybe it was too easy to make work like this. I thought what would happen actually if you took away that white wall and made it into a window, then you'd be dealing with architecture, because you have outside and inside together. And 2 years later, I did a very big show of architecture models at the Oxford Museum of Modern Art. There were about 10 architecture models, because I always like placing my work between two disciplines. My first work was magazine pages, which were also conceptual art and criticism. I did video art, which is also about television, and I wanted to do work that was both art and architecture at the same time, being between the two. I like hybrids. Now every artist wants to be an architect, like Vito Acconci. My work is neither architecture nor art. It's right on the edge. So from the models I made, I made a series of models. Some were situations for suburban projects that were never realized, and other works were like pavilions that you find in parks, or like telephone. They could be also in the city. They could be telephone booths, or bus shelters. And And my video work was always urbanistic. So here I'm interested in the park's relationship to the urban situation. This is one of the first works of mine that was realized from a model. It was two adjacent pavilions, and it was shown in Documenta in 81. I'm using two-way mirror glass, which is sometimes called one-way mirror glass. It's a glass that's mirror reflective on the outside if it gets a lot of sunlight, and then transparent on the inside. What I use it, and actually big office buildings always use it for office buildings and bank buildings in the center of the city. This work is two booths with two-way mirror glass on the outside, and they're not that large. They're about 2.3 meters high and 2.3 meters on the sides. There's enough room that you can go inside of either of the pavilions, and there's enough room for about four or five people standing up and two people lying down. In fact, in Documenta, many young students who came to see Documenta couldn't get hotel reservations, so couples were sleeping inside. But even though they're both two-way mirror glass, next slide. They were actually different. Because one of the pavilions had a transparent roof, which was transparent glass, and the other booth, the other pavilion had opaque glass inside, opaque ceiling, so it was dark inside. Next slide. This is the view inside the pavilion that has the opaque ceiling. As you can see, it tends to be it's dark inside, and when it's dark, you can actually see outside the pavilion. And you can see it's very much involved with landscape and also mirroring your own view. And on the outside of that pavilion, people could see people could only see themselves mirror reflected, because the light falls on the two-way mirror glass outside, and it becomes only reflective. Next slide. This is the view from inside the pavilion that has a transparent ceiling. When it's full sunlight, when there's no clouds, it's just as bright inside as it is outside. So people outside can see themselves reflected on people on the inside looking at them. Two people are looking at each other. But it's always changing because the sunlight keeps changing. Sometimes it gets dark, and sometimes is more light. When I first saw the piece, there was a police siren, there were police, there was a dog barking. The pavilion that was reflective on the outside was where the police action was. Actually, it turns out somebody had gone inside, leaving their dog outside, and the dog couldn't see them. so the dog was barking very loudly. Maybe people thought the dog was dangerous of some kind. One more slide. This is a normal two-way mirror glass that you see in Los Angeles. It's normally just reflective on the outside, reflecting the sky. But I'll talk about that in a second. Now I have a video for the first DVD of the two adjacent pavilions when it was relocated in the Kreuzlingen Mueller in Holland. Turn off the slides. Just to warm up, maybe. Mm-hmm. I wanted work that would be both like a park pavilion, architecture pavilion, and also be art at the same time. Oh, here we go. Okay. Do we have the sound?
First, I investigated the role of the park, the suburbs, and even the cemetery relative to the beginning of the new bourgeois city-state after the Enlightenment. And I realized that that the park, in a way, was a utopian preserve. Just as Jean-Jacques Rousseau had the idea of going back to the primitive hut and to nature as a way away from the corrupting effects of the city, so the park and architecture and art in a park had that utopian idea with it. In fact, all of architecture took on that same utopian idea, where each new building became a blueprint for utopia in the future, but ultimately was in competition with the city and with every other building. So I had to accept like the problem of the utopian falsity or illusion.
All my work is near grass, so people can lie down
and
outside.
Public sculpture.
You can see them, see what's happening. It's actually in the entrance of Croix de Müller Museum in Holland. There you can see people on the outside can see me on the inside. And you have the superimposition of the people outside looking and the people inside looking. It's about what I call intersubjective perception. People perceiving other people as they're perceived by as they perceive themselves, as other people perceive them. Sartre said the ego begins this way, with children seeing themselves being seen by other people who they see at the same time. That was my late hippie period. I just I looked like Charles Manson at one point, but then I cut my beard to be very normal. This was in the early 80s. Oh, that's it. Take it off. Okay, we go to the slides now. Next slide. This is a Mir pavilion, Amalienburg. It's a Rococo period in Munich. The pavilion is part of a palace complex, and it's in the shape of a pheasant, but it has a mirrored room. The mirrored room has four windows at each cardinal direction: east, west, south, north. And then between the windows are two mirrors. When you look out the windows, you can see topiary and the kind of Rococo landscape vegetation, and that's represented with little pieces of silver on the mirror where it's kind of embossed. The pavilion is only used when the king is there. The king actually shoots pheasants on the top of the roof, and the building is in the shape of a pheasant. The king actually, just like Louis Couture's, could turn gold into silver into gold alchemically. So actually, when the windows are open, the silver mirroring becomes gold. And actually, every direction, every time you look at the mirror, you can see all the other four directions, and the outside and inside. So, and also, I noticed that corporate buildings, when they have two-way mirror glass, corporate buildings in the 70s and 80s were very worried, because in America, Jimmy Carter was very, very much in favor of the environment, and people thought corporations were destroying the environment. So what the corporations did in using two-way mirror glass is they showed the sky on their facade. But it was also like, so the corporation is able to change everything, the corporate power into nature. with their product. But also it became surveillance. In other words, people on the inside of the building could look outside without being seen because the light is on the outside being reflected on the two-way mirror glass. Outside, you couldn't see the people inside. So it was the beginning. And what my work tries to do is to have both two-way mirror glass that's transparent and reflective. In other words, I try to make heterotopias out of the kind of cynicism of corporate office buildings. Okay, next slide. This is another early piece I did, which was originally a model. Next slide. And these are two works that were models for suburban situations. This is two adjacent pavilions. It was never realized physically, but of course, architecture models can show fantasy and fantasy possibilities. In some ways, Gordon Mata Clark and I were doing very similar work at that time. It was a time when Jimmy Carter said that we shouldn't produce goods. We should actually save environment and natural resources. So I wanted to do work that would be cut away, that you wouldn't add to anything or make an object, but actually cut away. So this is an American house, which is called a ranch house. These houses had very big living room windows called picture windows. Here I make the window into a sheet of glass. And halfway back is another mirror which has doors. In front of these houses, you can have the kitchen, the living room, a living room, and the dining room. That's the public area. And then on the other side of the mirror is the private area, the bedroom, the studio, and the toilets. This was a normal American suburbia situation. What happens is on the mirror is reflected the house facades. Next slide. Is reflected the facades of the houses across the street. My work is trying to combine Mies van der Rohe's Farnsworth house, which is the glass house I don't have a slide for, and Venturi. Next slide. The house in the middle is a Venturi house. Venturi always tried to deal with suburban reality, in other words, what suburbs are like. And he took the composition of the house in the middle. The windows reflect windows for this house over here. This color is from this house, and also it's reflecting the windows from this house. See this echoes these windows over here. Venturi was interested in the actual suburban environment as it is. Mies van der Rohe was interested in a kind of aristocratic house in the middle of the countryside. It was a glass house, but nobody could be seen anywhere because it was in the middle of nature. So I always try to combine things that can't be combined. Let's go back again in the slide. Venturi often talks about houses as billboards, like the things you see on signs from a highway culture. Actually, there are often signs for these new houses being built that show it as a very beautiful kind of situation in a nice countryside. But here you can actually see, when you go by in a car, you can actually see the actual houses reflected. And also, it's not so much public and private are mixed, and people who are walking between the houses can see themselves reflected in the mirror. So nothing is safe. They think they're safe when they're walking down the street between the houses, but in fact, it reveals the entire space, inside and outside. Next slide, and the slide after that. This is another project that comes a lot from Venturi. It took a while to be realized, but it was realized. It's a normal house. Venturi says that people who are Italian-Americans and buy a house, they always show what life is like by having statues of the manger, the Virgin Mary and the Christ child outside. If they're German, they might have little dwarfs. So the idea, you put ornamentation outside to show what your life is like on the inside. So this is the beginning of the video projector. It had just arrived, and what I do outside is my ornament is a video projection of what people are watching inside. This model was remade. I did it before it was The Simpsons. People can be watching The Simpsons. There's in America, there's educational television, so people might be reading, showing educational television, or at night they might be looking at pornography. Next slide. This is a show at Munster called Sculpture. In the 80s, there were many exhibitions that were taking place in university cities, in gardens. They often used palaces. And these summer shows, we were very much involved with the city, the plan of the city, and also its relationship to public buildings. This is an octagonal pavilion. Next slide. The main palace of Munster was octagonal, and there were 8 different alleys. In other words, slices of the pie. In the center of every alley, there was a pavilion. Only one survived. So the person who organized the show suggested to me to put a pavilion where the slides used to be in the original plan. You can see I've sited it right in the center. It's halfway between the palace and the edge of the garden. Okay, go back. It's two-way mirror glass. The roof is wood, 15 degrees slope of wood. I got that actually from Aldo Rossi, the architect, because it looks like a kind of old rustic building. So I'm trying to relate this to the history of the city, of the European city. Next slide, go advance to. Inside it becomes kaleidoscopic. There's a wood pole on the inside, and little children like to rotate themselves around the pole, a little like go-go dancers, women like to do this in go-go bar, in strip bars. And the work is very much for parents. In other words, it's photo opportunities for parents and for children for having fun. These exhibitions were always done in the summer, and Munster is very near Holland, and the Dutch really love art. Munster used to be part of Holland, so it's just full of family groups going through the park and experiencing the work. My work always has this kind of playful feeling to it. Next slide. This is a work that was done and not realized in 1989 for International Garden Year in Stuttgart. Every 3 years in Germany, a major German city redesigns their public parks, and they have an exhibition called International Garden Year, where people come to buy plants, seeds, garden implements, and of course it's a way to redesign the city. They asked me actually in 89 to do meeting places. In this park, two-way mirror hedge labyrinths. This project was turned down. I eventually was done for a collector in California. I'm very interested in the hedge labyrinth, which was used in French formal gardens and then an English garden a little bit later. There's always a labyrinth with hedges, but what I have here is hedges and two-way mirror glass together, to create a kind of virtual reality. And it's also relating old hedge mazes to the hedges that are used in normal houses today, which show the boundary between outside space and inside space. Next slide. This is a project, the hedges are just growing in this. This is a project I did for a collector in La Jolla, California. We'll put on the next DVD, and that will explain, and that'll be a good explanation. So one says two. Yeah. Hedge labyrinth, yes. The work is from 1989. It was part of an exhibition called International Garden Year. Every 3 years in Germany, a different park is designated International Garden Year. It means renovating and newly designing all the parks of a city and inside the parks. So it's about landscape architecture, redefining the city. And inside this redefined park area are garden shows. So people who are suburban garden lovers can come and shop for flowers, seeds, and other garden things. The idea of International Garden Year was to have meeting points which would have artworks. So I designed two-way mirror labyrinth near a bridge as a kind of meeting point. Hedges are very important to me. They relate to modern suburban settings where the hedges define property lines, public and private, boundary lines with Baroque labyrinth gardens. And
that's
garden,
a Mexican gardener trying to start his lawnmower.
The labyrinth is very important not only for hedges, but it defines the idea of the city.
This piece was in San Diego. A rich collector who, of course, employed Mexican laborers.
A kind of virtual space. The hedges should be semi-opaque, so from a distance you can't see through them, but they're transparent when you get closer. Just the opposite of two-way mirror, which is both transparent and reflective and shifting at every moment. The two-way mirror reflects people on either side, lost in a labyrinth. So you become lost in a labyrinth of virtual reality. The two-way mirror also is emblematic of the center of the city, which seems to always have an office building, which is two-way mirror. So it's in the project for La Jolla, for Bob Orton, I wanted to keep the tree in the center because I think that was the center part of the area. The swing was for a small child, so I saw it from the child's point of view and Bob Orton seeing everything through a small child. And I wanted to continue the hedges that
define
the area.
The labyrinth continues the normal hedges.
I think it's a great piece.
And I kept the old tree in the center because I didn't want to destroy the old tree. And also the swing was very important because he'd been married many times, but he had a young child by a Chinese woman artist. And that's where she was, she used a swing. So it's from her point of view. In other words, I always support the family structure in my work, even if it's a little bit difficult. She eventually left him because she wanted to pursue her career in New York. Okay, stop. And we'll go to the next slide. Next slide. This is the same piece you just saw. Next slide. This is a piece I did actually in France. Something very important was happening in France in the 80s. The Mitterrand government, the socialist government, wanted to regionalize art to get it away from Paris. So most of the art centers were actually in parks that had chateaus, and then overlays of different different periods of garden. The English garden, the French formal garden, the English garden, the 19th century garden. This was a park called Clisson. It was actually an island. Originally, it was developed as a kind of theme park for Poussin painting, Poussin temples from Poussin paintings, because a follow of Poussin who bought land after the revolution that was cheap in Brittany and France, and he designed he built temples like Greek temples in Poussin paintings. I wanted to do something that would go across the river. But it was too expensive, so I had to make my own little canal. One side is a pergola of the triangle. It has vines growing up, and the other side is two-way mirror glass. And you, on the grid, you can walk across the water. So it's all about reflections. As it gets toward dark, you get lots of shadowing from the vines, so it becomes very romantic. Next slide. This is how it was used. Next slide. This is another project I was doing at the time. I had done a lot of video, but I was getting very upset when video artists. My video was always very simple. It was more like television. But when artists like Bill Viola and even Gary Hill were doing these huge spectacles, I wanted to go back to the idea of people lying down and relaxing to see videos. So I designed in 1985 this two-way mirror hedge labyrinth. Design for showing video. It's both two-way mirror and normal glass. And it shows, and there's six different areas that have small TV monitors showing different video programs. People could lie down and actually relax and look at the videos in their section, but it's like an old drive-in theater. You can see people, other people looking at the other videos. You can see them reflected, and everything is re-reflected. I want to my video work and most of my work to be in a situation where you're not standing up, looking up in awe, but lying down. It's very good for teenagers to spend a lot of time, or old people sitting on benches. In other words, I want to relate video art to normal television. Next slide. This is what it looks like. You can see the superimposition of one space onto another space. I was very involved in design because in the 60s, many of the great artists like John Chamberlain, Andy Warhol, Art Schwager, Oldenburg, they're all artist design. It was a very big time for design, and I was kind of emulating this. This was done in 85 originally. I showed this at the Reina Sofia, in the first show I did at the Reina Sofia. It's a good way to show other people's videos or my videos. Next slide. This is a Dia Foundation piece that I did. Originally, I conceived this as a model in the middle 80s, and it was finally realized in 1991. 91 just went down about 2 years ago. It's on the roof, and it's a two-way mirror cylinder inside a two-way mirror cube. I was the first person to show at the Dia Foundation, and they wanted me to go inside, but I need the outdoor sunlight, and also inside, all the things at Dia are shown as if they're very religious. You have to be far away from them and look at them meditatively. I want something that could be like an outdoor ICA. I designed it to be used for performance. Thurston Moore of Sonic Youth and Laurie Anderson wanted to perform, although it never happened. Next slide. The cylinder is the same shape as the water tower, which is on top of the roof. So it was very much like a normal penthouse roof or a slum roof in New York. Outside of the pavilion, there's kind of rubber material that I found in playgrounds where you could lie down, relax. There's also a cafe. I'm very much dealing with the Baroque as against a Renaissance perspective because the curved two-way mirror glass of the cylinder shows your body distorted as you the image moves with you, and that is also reflected in the cube which has Renaissance perspective. It's flat, and I wanted to be a symbol of the city in many ways, like the Eiffel Tower is in Paris, and you can see the city grid. And you can also now we'll show a video. I made a video catalog, and this is the beginning of the video catalog. So we'll put on the next video.
¿Puedes subir un poco el sonido?
It's on the roof so you can hear the police helicopters. Good for boys on, inside the cylinder because they see themselves as supermen, or whereas on the other side it's a fisheye lens and women can see themselves very thin.
Echoes the rectilinear grid of New York City.
And as the sky changes, the image is always changing between being more reflective and more transparent on either side. But people see each other on either side. I used a boardwalk material because I thought that that it's on the edge of the Hudson, and I thought Battery Park City would be coming up. It would be like Coney Island situation. So for some reason, they made a mistake on this. Well, turn it off. Just keep it. There's a video. I think the person who did the video for me made a mistake on it. It begins inside the coffee. There's a small cafe where I have inexpensive coffee, and I made a videotech there because it was when I did the piece. It was the late '80s, and the only kind of art that people were interested in was neo expressionism, and I wanted to have videos from architecture. Wanted to have videos from performance work from the '70s, music videos, and also cartoons and videos from architecture offices. And I was trying to combine 1970s 1970s alternative space where you had performances with 1980s corporate atrium where you had a coffee bar. For some reason we're not translating this. I don't know why. And we'll go to the slides now. No, take that off. We'll go to the slides. Take that off. We'll stay in there. This is a skateboard pavilion, which was never realized. This was also done for International Garden Year. I don't know why there's no translation. It's okay? Okay. I thought that parks don't take care of teenage culture because teenagers are known for doing graffiti in public places. But I noticed in the Haywood Gallery, which is brutalist concrete, there were skateboarders. So I wanted to combine skateboarding and high art. My friend at the time was Thurston Moore of Sonic Youth, and he introduced me to a magazine called Thrasher, which was a skateboarding magazine. And I saw this bowl-shaped skateboard, skateboard situation. I decided that I would put a pyramid on top of it, which was two-way mirror glass, because in buildings, office buildings in the 1980s, every office building had on its roof a pyramid. But I cut away the pyramid. Next slide. Well, that one I got in upside down. This is from Thrasher magazine. Next slide. Go backwards too. Go backwards on the slides. Next, go back, one more. When a skateboarder goes up in the air, they see themselves re-reflected against the sky. And also because I did a cutaway of the top, you can see, it looks very psychedelic. It's like Lucy in the Sky with diamonds. So what I wanted to try to do was psychedelicize this 1980s corporate fascist pyramids. In the end, it was never done. It was almost done in the city of Leeds for the year 2000, and my ex-friend Vito Acconci started doing skateboard parks based on the skateboard pavilion. I like the fact that it can be graffitied. In fact, it works with graffiti. Now teenagers are destroying a lot of my work, but in fact, if I was a teenager, I might also destroy a Dan Graham work. If this was built, the skateboarders actually would design the skateboarding section. I would just do the top. Okay, next slide. This is the Heart Pavilion, which I did in 1991 for the Carnegie International in Pittsburgh. I find that museums shouldn't be attacked. I think that they're very important for their lobbies, which are romantic meeting places. So in the lobby of the Carnegie Art Institute, I designed a heart pavilion. So people can meet at the heart, inside and outside. It's with two-way mirror glass. A collector wanted to buy this piece, but I never do copies or editions of pavilions. So my art dealer said, do a variation. So I did a variation for her outside. It's the same pavilion, except one side has perforated a stainless steel. Next slide. I put it, she saw it with her husband, and then her husband died. So I situated this so she could see it from her bedroom. That's a romantic heart. Outside is a very different piece, as you'll see for the next video. It's very near a swimming pool and a barbecue pit outside, and very much involved with landscape. So we'll put on the next video, which is the one that's already in. That's her cat, Oliver, who is a friend of mine, sunning himself inside the pavilion. You can see how important landscape is to my work in the next videos. That white material. Oh, what happened? It just cut off. Maybe it's dirty. Oh, now it's going again. See, this side you're looking through is perforated stainless steel. I found out about the material through Japanese architecture, Shinohara and Ichiko Hasegawa. It's now being used by many architects as facade. In fact, the new museum building facade in Valencia is a ripoff of this by Sojima. It's become a very common decorative material. It's pretty druggy, this piece. Unlike President Clinton, I did inhale marijuana in the 60s.
You have to photograph yourself. That's what you don't want to do.
Okay, stop, and we go to the next slide. This is another interesting piece. It's the a Star of David piece. There's a collector in Austria who has a castle, and this is a period in Europe when everybody wanted their castle to be to show art. I decided, at first I didn't want to do anything in Austria because I'm Jewish, and I know Kurt Waldheim, who was president, was an old Nazi. But then, using a kind of Jewish humor, I decided to do a pavilion in the area that's the moat, which is the water area. It used to be water. It would be a water pavilion in the shape of a Star of David. Because Austria is in denial about the Jewish Holocaust still. Many Austrian artists, like Adolf Reiner, do work about the cross and blood. So I thought I'd do something about the water and the Star of David. This is a pavilion which is two triangles. One triangle is water basin, and on superimposed on this is a solid triangle. So you go inside the solid triangle, which is two-way mirror, and then you can walk on top of the water as Jesus Christ did. This is what it looks like. People in Austria didn't think that it had anything to do with the Jewish star, but if you walk toward the castle on the drawbridge, you can look down and you see it's a Jewish star. Okay, we have the next video. Yes, take this off. Oh, we advanced too far. It kept going. You have to go backwards. Oh, there it is. Got it.
The piece is in the shape of a Jewish David star. 8 years ago, when I conceived the piece, being Jewish, I didn't want to have an exhibition or do a large piece in Austria, thinking of Kurt Waldheim. And I was also thinking of all of the Adolf Reiner paintings of crosses. So I thought, from a serious and also a humorous point of view, a Jewish star would be very good. Using the water, the river, and also a reservoir nearby. And I also had the idea of Jesus walking on water.
Immer so einen Schritt auf die Seite, einfach so hin und her. Ah, Action.
So, you've been here since today?
Yeah,
but I experienced them, so memory to work.
Marie! The sun is going down.
This is what it's like in the winter. Okay, stop this. Stop that, and we go to the slide. This is another interesting situation. In Norway, in the early 90s, there's a lot of money from oil, and actually a very progressive socialist government. So many small towns near the North Pole decide they would have artists do work in the North Pole. There's a Gulf Stream. There's a warm a water stream that comes up to Norway. So in the summer, it's a wonderful vacation situation. Many people have seen this piece. I designed a simple piece, which is a pavilion. It's a triangle, but the two sides are just a normal flat two-way mirror glass. You can enter inside, and the front actually is curved two-way mirror glass. Next slide. That's the winter. I sighted it. Actually, it's right near a fjord, so you can see it like a lighthouse by ships. Now we have the next video. Mm-hmm. And there's no sound on this. Actually, there is a sound. A little. You can see you can enter it. It's a very tight space, though. When this was videotaped, there was a storm. There's a ceiling and actually shelter from the rain. So people in the neighborhood call it a shower stall, like a shower. For some reason, girls seem to appreciate my work more than boys. Okay, turn that off, and now we have the next slide. This was a show in Munster 10 years ago. It's a piece, actually, I got the idea from this when I saw a painting of Robert Mangold in the Stedelijk. It's a parallelogram, one side curved, it's open. The theme for the show, which wasn't really realized, was to do two pieces based on the city plan. The city of Munster is Roman plan, so at the edge of the city is a bicycle path. This is where I placed this. And then I'll show you the work that was turned down, a children's daycare center for the center in a new addition to the museum. Next slide. And now we'll go to the next video. The curve of this pavilion reflects the Roman city plan. You can see Munster is a bicycle city, as many German cities are. You can see the helmets on the children. So now you see a young Japanese couple who've come to see the exhibition. See, my work deal in large exhibitions like this deals with international art tourism. Mommy. Okay, next slide. This is the other piece that was not realized. It's a children's daycare center. I realized in the 90s, the most important thing for museums is the education program where children come in from school, look at art. This is a place where children could look at cartoons, CD-ROMs, or videos about art. There are three screens. Two are perforated aluminum. And then children who aren't able to sit down could lie down inside looking at comic books. They could look at each other on either side of the curved half cylinder. It was not realized. Finally, I realized a project like this about 10 years later, which I'll show you. Okay, next slide. This is the elliptical pavilion, which I did in Berlin. It still exists in Berlin. Now we put on the number 29 in advance of. The one that says that's 2 and 9 together. Oh, great, we got it very fast. The elliptical pavilion originally was going to be on the side of the Spree River, which was going to be a city park walkway. It was to mimic three new elliptical buildings, aluminum buildings across the river. So the reflections would also come from the Spree River. People would lie down inside the ellipses, maybe roll around, have fun, and also outside. My work is always about lust pavilion, pleasure pavilions. And it always mimics the architecture of the city, but tries to make it utopian and a pleasure area. The ellipse is Baroque, and I'm trying to break minimal art and also 1980s corporate buildings, which are square and very involved with neo-fascist imagery. The Baroque now is light. It's coming into buildings because it's light, playful, and more gentle and kind. One side of the ellipse is a perforated steel, polished, and the other side, two-way mirror. With two-way mirror, whichever side gets more sun at any moment is more reflective, and the other side that gets less sun is more transparent. As the sky changes, it's always flicking back and forth. The work is about the clouds, people looking on either side. People can see each other on either side, gazing. So it's about the spectator, not the object, and about nature changing, a little like Caspar David Friedrich, but with ellipses. The piece was near a power plant, in other words, an alibi, because it was converted to nuclear power. It's also the new center of Berlin, near the new Hauptbahnhof, the old DDR area of East Germany. The housing is upper middle class or lower middle class East German mass housing, not very attractive.
Those are social housing for the East German period.
Quite beautiful.
And these are people who've lived there all their lives.
Of the neighborhood people, particularly the old folks and passing teenagers.
Slide, and that's all for that DVD. Next slide. This is a similar piece I did actually for a sculpture park in Sweden. Both sides are ellipses, but they have different radiuses, and the shape is the same shape as the lake that is next to. Next slide. Next slide. This is a piece that took about 10 years to do. It's the Yin Yang Pavilion. The blue is actually water. I did this because in the 90s, everybody was interested in New Age. Many people became Buddhists. And the most popular artist in America, maybe the world, was Bill Viola. So in a way, this is a parody of Bill Viola. It's two-way mirror glass dividing the yin and the yang. So the yin was the water, and the other side, the yang, is like a Zen Buddhist garden, but without the rocks. I've simplified it. It was finally realized in a dormitory at MIT, designed by Stephen Hull, which is many students are Chinese or Chinese American. So we'll put that video on right now. Yin Yang was conceived in the mid-90s as a kind of send-up and parody of New Age religion, which was very prominent in the 90s. I think the 80s were about greed is good, capitalism, and the 90s everything was about kind of New Age pieties. Many people became Buddhists. A certain prominent video artist was very involved with a kind of corporate New Age Zen Buddhism, sponsored by Sony. And my piece actually was finally realized in an MIT dormitory by architect Stephen Hull, which is about, student-wise, is about 50% Chinese and Chinese-American students. So the piece actually is a yin on one side, and the yang is a white gravel, which is a kind of a Zen Buddhist garden without the rocks. So as I've simplified it, it might be a little like an aquarium actually. It's very much relative to the sun, which is available on both sides through the windows. And as the sun changes, the relative transparency as against reflectiveness of the two-way mirror glass changes. You see, I use two-way mirror glass differently from corporations. In corporations, it's like a surveillance situation. It's reflected on the outside of the two-way mirror glass, where the sun
sun illuminates it. The outside is reflective and reflecting the sky, because actually corporations in the 70s, when they had two-way mirror glass, were worried about public thinking they were despoiling the environment. So the idea is it reflects the sun away, cuts down air conditioning costs, and the outside of the two-way mirror glass looks like the sky. Corporations identified themselves with the environment. And on the inside, it was transparent. People can look outside but not be seen, like a surveillance camera. What I do is I make it both transparent and reflective at the same time. I think my work relates a lot to Hudson River School Church, Bierstadt. I'm interested in being an American, Caspar David Friedrich. Thanks for your attention.
It's like a Bill Viola, but Bill Viola now does Catholic imagery, going back to his past, Italian Catholic. Okay, next slide. Next slide. This is a piece I did about 3 years ago at the Haywood Gallery in London. It is a children's daycare center with cartoons, CD-ROMs, cartoons, but it also has videos of art in the collection, it's closer to architecture than even the Dia piece, and I designed it with the help of an architect, so we can put on the next video. There are two videos, one after the other. One was made by the Haywood Gallery itself, and the other was made by me.
The Haywood Gallery is a contested building. Its brutalist exterior, perceived by some as an icon of 60s architecture, but by others as hostile and unwelcoming, has been unhelpful in terms of positive public perception. When the Haywood was built in 1968, no provision was made for a cafe, an education or entertainment space, and regrettably, disabled access was not at the top of the agenda either. In order for the Haywood to enhance visitors' experiences beyond its reputation for its internationally acclaimed gallery spaces, it needs to address visitors' expectations. In 2002, the decision was made to give the entrance a welcoming facelift. While the impetus for this foyer extension was rooted in a functional brief to improve facilities and access, it was driven by the Haywood's commitment to artistic innovation, and the decision was made to involve an artist from the outset. Dan Gray, an American artist famous for his two-way mirror glass pavilions, was the choice of Haywood's director, Susan Ferliger Braids.
I thought of Dan first for a number of reasons. He had done Café Bravo at Kunstwerke in Berlin, and I knew that the way in which people interacted with his work was important to him. His work reaches out to people, whether because they're engaging with its reflections or they're playing on the video screens that he often provides.
Once Dan had accepted the Haywards' invitation, the next step was to find an architectural firm to collaborate with him.
Luckily for us, we found the practice Howarth Tompkins. Graham Howarth had some incredibly important credentials. He, like Dan Graham, was interested in The Fall, Joy Division, The Buzzcocks, and they had codependent astrological signs. Very important to Dan, given his interest in anthropology and stereotypes.
Their partnership proved to be ideal, and they set about designing the new facade, which includes a double-height glass foyer, a new cafe, a lift for disabled access, and the scheme's centerpiece, the two-way mirror glass pavilion.
Wow, it is a wow moment, isn't it?
So Shinohara, you can't believe it. It reminds me of Alice in Wonderland.
Does it? You just came through a little hole into a...
Yeah.
I think you've shrunk. So what do you think?
It looks like it fits very nicely.
Well, I told Graham Haywood that I didn't like architecture that was too tasteful. In other words, English architecture. I quoted Bruce MacLean, who called English art teacup art. So he's trying not to be that English. But I also wanted him to see architects often overdo the structure, whereas he understands that it's the mirror quality that's more important.
Dan obviously had an idea about what pavilion he wanted to put on the roof, and where we came in was to try and see what the boundaries of that intervention might be, where the pavilion stopped and started, and where the other things like the lift and the staircase interfaced with the pavilion. So when the form of the ellipse began to evolve and a decision was taken that it should be an elliptical form, we then adapted what was going next to it to accommodate that. So there was this conversation of how the two things should look, whether they should look identical, whether they should have the same material qualities, or whether they should be completely different.
Dan Graham's trademark has become his use of two-way mirror glass, which combines clear, mirrored, and semi-reflective glass in a technique which he calls the mirror effect. For Graham, the pavilions are very much dependent on their context and use. Whoever's inside or looking at the pavilion is somehow implicated in the work because they are reflected in it.
In two-way mirror glass use in corporations, it's always a surveillance situation. It's always reflective on the outside, and from the inside you can see through. Here, I deconstruct that. It's half reflective and half clear simultaneously. In this piece for the Haywood Gallery, there are video screens, touch video screens on both sides of three panels in the center of the ellipse. Using punched aluminum in two of them means that you can look through it like a peephole, the people on the other side. And also the videos are re-reflected in the two-way mirror glass. And as the video screens change, as the sunlight changes, there's a constant flux. You're able to see other people seeing themselves, seeing other people.
Dan's pavilions are seen as works of art, but they can also be seen as architecture. In Dan's view, architects often steal ideas from artists, and artists often want to try their hand at architecture.
Well, I think there's a disease out there. Architects want to be artists, and artists want to be architects. Yeah. It's a horrible disease, which I think I began.
You did. When does a building become a piece of art, and when does a piece of art become a building? It's very ambiguous. I think it's very difficult for architects to work at that, really. Artists are much more au fait, I think, with working with ambiguity and contradictions, you know, differences between inside and outside, whereas architects want sort of clear boundaries, clear divisions about what things are doing. That approach has impacted on the way we've designed the other part of the building, and I think that the two now work together as complementary elements.
The reason I got into architecture was because my first work was about the city plan. Homes for America was not about the white cube, which I thought was a simplistic idea, but about the city plan of New York. I was influenced by my friend Saul DeWitt, who worked for I.M. Pei, and his grids were the city plan of New York as a grid. Dia Foundation is also about the city plan. It's my hobby, two hobbies, writing about rock music and visiting architecture. I'm an architectural tourist.
Dan Graham conceived the Pavilion as a drop-in center for children and old people, and a place where they could come and watch cartoons.
The playful aspect of my work is very important. And I think in these Muir Pavilions, it's about play, just play, sense of play.
The Pavilion, which has been titled Waterloo Sunset at the Hayward Gallery, stands as a tribute to Dan's early memories of London through its music scene and the Kinks.
But when I think about England, I always think through the eyes of rock music.
There's another video on the way coming after this, just keep it on.
No, keep it on. Because here it is, right here. It's situated so it's free for the general public walking along the walkway of the Thames. It's also used for education programs for children who visit the Hayward Gallery.
Why don't you go around the other side and see what you get?
Nice show.
The outside is equally important, although we don't have too much video of the outside. It can be seen from the local bridge. So again, like the Dia piece, it's a landmark for the Hayward Gallery, a little like their own Eiffel Tower. Unfortunately, the new director, who wants to use the space for his own projects, says he's taking down the screens. Okay, we're almost at the end. Next slide. This is a very complex piece. It's a way to do a time delay without using mechanical means. It was turned down for the Documenta about 12 years ago, and I finally realized it in Portugal, in Porto, in the Cervales Museum in the garden. It's a little hard to understand. It's actually a triangular pavilion, two-sized two-way mirror. You can enter inside, and the front is a transparency, which is a photograph of the landscape 50 meters in front on a fall day. So you can actually look through the transparency and you can see time changing. The clouds change, the time of day changes, and eventually the seasons change, and it almost coincides 1 year later. It's a landscape pavilion with a still photograph. I wanted to do it with Jeff Wall, but he actually decided that he was against the work being done, actually. Maybe he thinks he has a trademark in Cibachrome. Now we have a video, and it's the last video here.
Triangular pavilion. It's sited in a landscape which has trees, and you can also see the sky with clouds. The triangular pavilion, which is enterable through a sliding door, has two two-way mirror sides, and the front side is a huge cibachrome transparency. The transparency is actually a photograph of the landscape viewed from inside the structure about 50 meters in front of the transparency side. So the transparency is taken on a fall day, nearly at sunset, and the spectators inside the structure can see the present landscape looking through the cibachrome slowly changing as the sunlight and time of the day and the season for the landscape keep changing. So they see moving time through the static image of the lightly exposed transparency of the past view. And then it goes through the different seasons, and 1 year later, exactly, the photograph transparency is almost the same, but slightly different from the original photograph view. This creates a time delay using a still photograph. Spectators inside the pavilion can look actually through either the two-way mirror sides, and they see themselves reflected on top of the landscape and also on top of people outside looking at them on the inside and vice versa. If they look directly in the corner where the two two-way mirror sides meet, they also see the cibachrome transparency, and they see everything prismatically re-reflected. Their continuous reflection and transparent views of the immediately surrounding landscape on both sides of this pavilion. The work is extremely landscape oriented, is now at the Cervales Museum in Porto, in the garden.
Okay, the last is an interview, very hard to translate. So this is the end of the talk. And actually, I'm going to show, as a special treat, my one-hour rock video, Rock My Religion. We were going to have an intermission, but I'm thinking about maybe it's better to have questions now. Don't you think? Because this was shorter than I thought it would be. By the way, I'm really happy about the translation, because I did speak fast, not slowly, but I think it turned out very well. So we have all the lights come up?
Bien, pues muchísimas gracias. Como ha dicho, hacemos un descanso de 20-25 minutos, vemos el vídeo Rock My Religion y se abre después un turno para el debate. Sobre todo, quería dar las gracias a Dan por la introducción a su obra, que creo que ha sido bastante, bastante iluminadora para todos los que no conocíamos o no acabamos de conocer del todo su obra. Así es que muchas gracias, Graham. Bien, vamos a seguir con la jornada y quizá para que sea un poco más, más dinámico y sobre todo porque venimos de la conferencia, en lugar de ver primero el vídeo y luego hacer las preguntas, hacemos o establecemos un turno de 15-20 minutos de debate y después vemos el vídeo. Así es que, bueno, la palabra la tenéis ahora. Tenemos el micro para la traducción simultánea. Bien, pues la primera pregunta para romper el hielo, si no hay ninguna. Lo que me gustaría preguntar es, o intentar saber exactamente cuál es el referente, si es que hay algún referente, el referente último para el uso del espejo o el uso del reflejo dentro de su obra. Algunos teóricos hablan del uso que realiza Manet en el bar de Folies Bergère, otros sobre el uso del espejo en Las Meninas, algunos lo han relacionado con la teoría de Jacques Lacan, o incluso luego después el uso que hace Smithson del espejo, pero me gustaría saber exactamente de dónde lo toma o cuál es el referente último del uso del espejo y sobre todo del reflejo. Se sabe ya.
I'm not that intellectual, but when I was 14, I read Jean-Paul Sartre's Being in Nothingness. I hated high school. So I thought everything was nausea, like Sartre's novel Nausea, and I read the part of Being in Nothingness where he talks about the mirror stage, which Lacan took a lot of ideas from. So in fact, it's my early readings as a teenager. Also, I read a lot of science fiction, but I never went to art school or university, so I never studied Lacan, and I didn't know anything about Velázquez. I think maybe these things come from childhood and teenage memories and experiences. That's true with most artists. Things come from your childhood experiences.
Por su relación con Smithson y el uso que hace él del espejo.
Smith, I had an art gallery that Smithson wanted to show with, so he became very close to me. But I think that Smithson took a lot of things from Borges. He also learned a lot from English artist Keith Arnett, who did Mirrors on the Ground. Smithson was aware of all the best artists around him, but I think he wrote an article about Art Deco because he was very involved in fashion, and I think he saw in the Daily News building in New York the Art Deco use of mirrors, pretty much. So I think his work comes from interior decoration, and my work comes from architecture. So, and actually my interest in gardens and garden design comes from his article on Olmsted, but I think his interest is more mannerist. Mine is more baroque.
Yo no voy a preguntar más.
Everybody's too shy.
No, pero te está escuchando ella.
Creo que es extraordinariamente sugerente, impregnante o extraordinariamente situaciones en las que los pabellones estaban metidos en la naturaleza o en el que el juego de los reflejos era de una determinada escala. Y, por ejemplo, el usuario o los personajes que se relacionaban con estos pabellones tenían mucho que ver con los niños, con el juego o con situaciones así como muy... muy poco, incluso yo diría que poco urbanas, aunque al principio usted ha dicho que realmente estaba siempre trabajando como más en la ciudad, ¿no? Sin embargo, el edificio o la propuesta para el museo, que es una propuesta que es de ampliación de un edificio y que ya el programa es más previsible o que realmente está haciendo una colaboración con un arquitecto, me produce una pequeña frustración con respecto al resto de experimentos y al resto de riqueza perceptiva que había en las otras propuestas. ¿Hay un límite de escala para el trabajo con un material como el cristal, sin carpintería, sin otra poesía añadida que la de la lámina plana o curva? ¿Hay un límite de escala a partir del cual estos experimentos pueden estar siendo fallidos? Lo digo porque, por ejemplo, ha hablado usted de la arquitectura o se ha referido a Kazuyo Sejima, que está ahora mismo como dando ese siguiente salto de escala en el Iván o en algún museo en Estados Unidos o en la vivienda esta de la Flor. A mí me interesa esto y, desde luego, no tengo la respuesta, no es una pregunta trampa, pero sí que reconozco que me ha frustrado un poco ese edificio, esa ampliación, y quizá lo hay un límite, no lo sé.
Scale and how children play and not in very urban situations, mm-hmm. although at first you said your work is very urban. However, your proposal regarding the art gallery in London was quite frustrating for him because regarding the rest of your work, because he would like to know if is there a limit when you work with glass or when you work with mirrors, besides curves and flat mirrors, or?
Well, I never use flat mirrors. I never use flat mirrors. Basically, my work is even when it's in nature. I use two-way mirror glass, which is from the center of the city. And of course, in the Hayward Gallery, it's right next to the Thames and the sky. So in fact, it's a little like the artist's constable. It's about the clouds. And secondly, I'm a little like an architect. If people give me a situation, I relate to that situation. And I always thought that museums are social spaces, and they're particularly social spaces for children now in education situations. Maybe my work has changed. In that it's getting closer to real architecture, but I have to remind people that my hero was Dan Flavin and also Saul LeWitt, who was an architect originally, and Flavin took from Russian constructivism. In other words, my work has always been quasi-functional, and I like the ambiguity where it's halfway between being landscape and halfway between being urban architecture. But of course, I grew up in the suburbs, so my real reference is to the edge of the city and the suburbs. I also want to make another reference. I'm a product of the 60s, and the most important philosopher of the 60s was Marcuse. And Marcuse talked about going back to the polymorphous perverse sexuality of children. He also emphasized play. So my work is not that serious. I had a very unhappy childhood, so I want to give happy childhood experiences to everybody and myself.
No, relacionado con eso, pregúntale qué papel juega el sentido del humor dentro de su obra y si no cree que el sentido del humor es una cosa que, que ha sido siempre puesta como fuera de la historia del arte y que es constituyente esencial del arte contemporáneo.
I think before there was conceptual art, which was high seriousness, I was doing a kind of conceptual art with magazine pages that was very much about anarchistic humor. You see, artists try to undermine, they're subversive. So we do this with humor and parody. Certainly Smithson believed in humor also. I think he was interested in Borges in terms of literature. I was very influenced by the early films of Jean-Luc Godard, which had a kind of wit and humor to them, and also a sense of openness. And of course, I was very influenced by Roy Lichtenstein and his humor. And in rock music, I like the humor and anarchism of the Ramones. And by the way, I'm Jewish. Two of the Ramones were Jewish. The leader of the group, Tommy, was Jewish, and he was fascinated with fascistic children and boys in his neighborhood. So it's a Jewish way of dealing with fascism by undermining it with humor. But I think all the artists who I like had a sense of humor. Saul LeWitt. I gave Saul LeWitt his first one-man show when I had a gallery. He told me that his first grids were jungle gyms for his cats. In other words, like in a playground, cats could play on them. Yes.
Sí. No, quería pedir que comentara un poco su fascinación con el suburb, ¿no? El espacio de, es que en español no sabría cómo traducirlo, las urbanizaciones, el espacio de expansión urbana que tradicionalmente pues ha sido bastante denostado y criticado y como menospreciado por arquitectos, en fin, urbanistas, etcétera. Y usted parece que le encuentra cierta fascinación, juega con este tipo de espacio y ha hablado de que su niñez tuvo lugar en el suburb, ¿no? En estas áreas de expansión, urbanizaciones, fuera del casco urbano. Podría, no sé, comentar un poco más sobre esto. También estaba pensando, cuando ha dicho esto, en no sé, lo que hace a lo mejor John Baldessari con espacios similares en Los Ángeles, bastante despersonalizados, bastante retratados de una forma bastante plana. En fin, no sé si podría comentar algo sobre esto.
Okay, he wanted you to comment a little bit about your fascination for the suburbs, mm-hmm. and because it's been an area, there have been areas which have always been rejected by architects, but you seem fascinated because of those areas. So, and you mentioned mm-hmm. that you grown up in the suburbs. Maybe that's why. And he also mentioned Baldessari and mm-hmm. his work. So maybe it's related.
It's not related, but Baldessari is Italian American who grew up in a poor area which was somewhat suburban, Southern California. I grew up actually outside of the suburbs in a rural area, but I grew up when all the discussion was about the alienation of the suburbs, Ventrum Buchla says my work is sociological critique. I actually hate sociology. I think that in some ways my work is a little like Flaubert's writing, which is a kind of humorous. It's kind of a flat, deadpan humor, and I think the artists who I liked, Don Judd, Robert Mangold, and even Saul LeWitt, dealt with the new materials of the suburbs. So everything in the 60s was new, and it first happened in the suburbs. So I'm a product of the first concerns of minimal art, which were not about abstraction, but actually about the environment. And early Godard films like Weekend, Contempt, and one or two things I know about her dealt with this new kind of situation. Um,
But also the suburbs were very alienating, and people were frightened of them. But in fact, the thing about frightening things is that artists could turn them into something different. They deal with alienation and frightening situations. And in fact, many of the artists like Saul LeWitt and Dan Flavin really were fans of Adolf Speer, his light shows. This has nothing to do with your question, but after the war, everybody was, intellectuals were very against fascism, but they didn't realize that fascism was actually in advertising and corporate logos inside the new democracies. But I think the way to play with them is, I think my early work has a certain kind of gentle humor, and it's, I think it's poetic. So I think people are forgetting that the minimal artists all wanted to be writers. Smithson wanted to be like Borges. I wanted to be a writer. Flavin wanted to be like James Joyce. So there's a kind of literary humor. And of course, the suburbs were dealt with by many writers at that time.
Bueno, buenas tardes. Yo cuando he visto estas piezas en los parques, me ha parecido también un poco como si fueran una especie de laboratorio donde se estaba analizando las reacciones que tenía la gente que entraba dentro de estas piezas y veía y se ponía en la extrañeza de la situación de ser observado y observador de sí mismo, del otro. El otro también le observa, se observa y es como, no sé, me parece como que esto está dentro de una especie de experimento, no sé, sociológico, psicológico, y yo pienso, no sé, quiero saber si esto tiene algo de realidad y en qué consiste y qué conclusiones ha extraído a lo largo de su carrera en este sentido. Gracias.
He said that when he saw your works located in parks, he thought of a laboratory where people can enter when they locate themselves in a situation where they can look and be looked at the same time they watch and are watched at the same time. So he thinks that it's similar to a psychological and sociological experiment. So. Is it true?
No. And, yes.
Which are the conclusions that you have drawn from all those years of your career?
Well, I think my first work was involved with psychological models, but my earliest work was in video, was actually used to illustrate psychological and social ideas. And it was about learning process. But what I'd like to do is take a psychological, philosophical, and maybe sociological model and actually make it, idea, and make it into a laboratory-type situation. That's how the work began. But it actually began in video. I was very influenced by the psychologist Gregory Bateson, who had a theory about schizophrenia, the double blind theory. But I think in the 60s, everybody was interested in psychological theories. I don't know if you remember, but John Lennon believed in primal scream. So there are all these psychological ideas in the 60s, and I kind of in my performance work. And video, I was making fun of it. So when I went to the more architecture things, it comes really out of that early work. So I think you're right, but I think I've gone beyond that now. I think we're almost finished for time for question, but what about mujeres? Okay.
Bien, pues yo creo que lo que como última pregunta quizá nos podría servir de engarce con lo que vamos a ver después, preguntarle cuál es su relación con la música, con el rock y cómo se gestó la pieza o la concepción de la pieza que vamos a ver a continuación.
rock my religion.
Okay. You understood?
Yeah.
Okay, how was it conceived and what's your relationship with music and rock?
My relation with rock is that I was writing articles about rock music for as a kind of pleasurable hobby, so I could get tickets for shows for free and maybe meet some of the rock and rollers. When I was doing my first conceptual pieces, I wanted them to be like pop music, disposable, very fast and disposable. A lot of pop artists like Andy Warhol were interested in rock music at that time, but in the 1970s, the cities were dying. It was a time of Mata Clark. All the artists like Robert Longo and Richard Prince had their own rock band. So to me, rock was rock and roll. Was a kind of communalism for the art world. And it was about the family structure. It was very anthropological. So I'd written many articles. I'd also done pieces involving feminism. So I wanted in Rock My Religion to it was the beginning of MTV, and I wanted to attack MTV by doing a rock documentary. It was a little like my rock writings, but it was more like a film. And actually, my friends were Kim Gordon and Thurston Moore of Sonic Youth. They lived downstairs from me. They had needed ideas for songs, so they gave me two songs. My friend Glenn Branca, who had a huge influence on Sonic Youth, did some music for me. So basically, I was collecting in Rock My Religion. It's kind of a before sampling. It was a sampling of all my favorite songs. I was done with no money. It was very primitive. I had primitive equipment. The video you've seen has been deteriorated very badly because I never had money to take care of it. But the sound is in very good shape. And for me, it was the next thing to do after writing and doing feminist video. And I wanted a feminist heroine, so I selected Patti Smith. Through Thurston Moore, had all her fan was a member of her fan club, so I had all the information from the fan club about Patti Smith. It's also the last thing is it's about the relation in America because between the Industrial Revolution in England and American culture. And of course, American culture is utopian. And the film is super feminist. Yes, I was an early feminist. I'm not sure I'm such a feminist now, but I was a total feminist, so it's a feminist film. And Patti Smith finally saw it, and she liked it very much. It's also an attack on art because Patti Smith says that rock and roll as a religion surpasses everything you can find in art because it mixes all the genres together. In other words, it's a little like the German idea of a form that encompasses everything. In other words, like as Wagner was trying to do, but she was trying to do it in rock and roll. Okay, and I apologize with the bad visual quality. I also showed this film in Reina Sofia when it just opened, and a lot of young people saw the film and really liked it. I think people who are older will like the 50s section with Elvis Presley and Jerry Lee Lewis.
¿Podemos bajar la luz?
¿Y el sonido?
No,
de momento, vale. Un poco más alto. Okay.
Stanley, an illiterate blacksmith's daughter of Manchester, England, at the beginning of the Industrial Revolution, founded the Shakers. She worked in the cotton mills at 14, married to a man she disdained. The four children she bore died in infancy.
She was God, God's second coming in the form of a woman. For the Shakers, alone among American religious dissidents, the apocalypse had been fulfilled in Ann Lee. The goal of the Shakers was simply to achieve perfection here on Earth in their community.
Peasants' families were forcibly removed from their land in the country. There, reproduction of children had been an asset, but as workers in the city, starving children were exploited by factory owners as cheap labor.
This job at a piss factory in Spectrum Pipe. 40 hours a week, 36 bucks, it's real bullshit, but you know it's a paycheck, Jack. It's real hot here too, hot like Sahara, but all these bitches are just too lame to understand, too damn grateful to get this job to realize they're getting screwed up the ass. Me, well, I wasn't saying too much neither. I was a moral little asshole, hardworking schoolgirl. I figure in a factory gotta earn my dough, but no, it ain't like that in a factory, see. You do your piecework and you do it slow.
Saw that heterosexual marriage, since Adam's sin in the garden, was responsible for the curse of alienated work and the burden of childbirth for the woman.
To the woman he said, I will multiply your pains in childbearing. You shall give birth to your children in pain. To the man he said, with sweat on your brow shall you eat your bread.
The mysteries of the universe lie in the sleeping sex of a woman. Now, back in Egypt, the Egyptian Book of the Dead was written because they got these like women that were like, you know, that were before the time after 1852. So like, they got these women and they put them in these like tomb shapes, like mummy shapes. Only they didn't mummyize them. What they do is they made this mixture up of opium and salad oil and henna. And they put it all over them. You know, they take, you know, first they'd knock them out with a sledgehammer. Then they'd lay them in there and then they'd wipe them all over with this opiate henna oil. Maybe throw a little murk in, anything they could get in there. Anyway, she'd do this and the scribes would be standing around with their papyrus or papyrus or peanut butter bag wrappers. No, Forget that one. They're sitting around with their scrolls, and anyway, she'd start babbling.
She saw that the language of the Egyptian priestesses could be merged with the religious revivalists talking in tongues to produce a new rock language, Babalog, neither male nor female. Anne Lee and a few followers left for America, a virginal Garden of Eden, in 1774. In America, the Shakers would construct a society which would resurrect the pre-industrial family, but in a utopian form. The coming of Anne Lee meant the beginning of the millennium. Based on sexual equality and sexual abstinence, the patriarchal family is now to be replaced by co-equal brothers and sisters. The economy was craft-based, with common ownership of goods. Men and women met twice a week in meetings, sitting 5 feet apart from their partners to discuss theological or practical matters. After a sober work week, the Shakers met on Sundays to worship. In the circle dance, lines of men and women formed concentric moving circles. The dance liberated the group from individual sin and helped them achieve a collective purity.
The first religious dissidents to arrive in America were the Puritans. More middle class and individualistic than the proletarian, communal Shakers, they believed that a man stood a good chance of going to hell, as all men inevitably were born evil. In 1890, the Plains Indians, having lost their land and buffalo, followed the religion of a new Messiah whose faith was a mixture of Christian and Native American beliefs. This new Messiah would punish the whites by means of his new faith based on the ghost dance. If the Indians danced with fervor and renounced all war and loved all people, the buffalo would return. The white men would be swept away, the dead would arise, and their lands would be returned. As they danced, they sung, "There shall be a buffalo chase. Make arrows, saith my father. Father, I came. Mother, I come. Father, give us back new arrows." The Sioux wore shirts decorated with symbols which they believed would defeat the white man's bullets, to prepare for victory and to receive in a trance more messages from the Great Spirit. Men, and also women, for the first time, danced in circles.
Perhaps the Sioux Indians' ghost dance, like the Shakers' circle dance, was a response to the Industrial Revolution's destruction of their family structure and way of life.
My belief in rock and roll gave me a kind of strength that other religions couldn't come close to.
In the 1950s, a new class emerges, a generation whose task is not to produce but to consume. This is the teenager.
So as not to add to post-war unemployment and liberated from the Puritan work ethic, their philosophy is fun. Their religion is rock and roll. Rock mocks parental sexuality and the parental belief that sexual repression and meaningful work are necessary for personal salvation. Rock heroes are unrepentant, fallen sinners.
Out of, listen, out
Mr.
of...
Philip,
I don't care, it ain't what you believe.
It's
what
it's
about.
The sublimating repression of the body, rock sexualizes the Shaker dance and the religious revivalist meeting. Rock turns the values of traditional American religion upside down. To rock and roll means to have sex now.
And we call it a Woody Surf City. Here we come.
Well, it ain't got a backseat or rear window, but it still gets me where I wanna go.
Going to Surf City, cause it's 2-1.
You know we're going to Surf City, gonna have some fun now.
Two girls for every. Two girls for every. Two girls for every.
Family life has lived in the 50s. In isolated suburban houses, family members link themselves to the outside through radio, TV, and the car. It is through these means of transport that teenagers and rock and roll communicate. In the song Teenage Heaven, written by Eddie Cochran, a new realm of teenage afterlife is suggested for Buddy Holly, Richie Valens, and the Big Boppers, victims of a tragic plane crash.
Which killed them on their way to a rock gig.
Some boy or girl. And with your star shining through the dark and lonely night to light the path and show the way that's right.
Gee, we're gonna miss you. Everybody sends their love.
Buddy, I can still see you with that shy grin on your face. Seems like your hair was always a little messed up. Kind of out of place. Now, not many people actually knew you or understood how you felt. But just a song, just a song from you could make the coldest heart melt. You're singing for God now. It is a chorus in the sky.
In the teenage heaven on earth, teenagers are teen angels. Their voices androgynous, angelically mutable. Their bodies are half-formed.
While adult culture had formerly viewed children as innocent angels, teens saw the angelic as relating to the ecstasy of first and purest sexual feelings. Sex is liberated from reproduction and the family and social responsibility.
Taken you away. I'll never kiss your lips again. They bury.
Is a way of avoiding growing up. The myth of James Dean is archetypal. Taking momentary body pleasures to their limit, transcends history or death, and in a world doomed, is even inevitable.
Take a look around you, boy. It's bound to scare you, boy. And you tell me over and over and over again.
The death of her rock idols of the 1960s led Patti Smith to question her belief in rock as a religion. She was the Mary Magdalene to all the fallen rock idols of the 60s.
Skin, emits a ray that I think. Sad. It's much too bad that our friends can't be with us today.
Is that girl put a spell on me?
You kind of did that for Jimi Hendrix.
Yeah, well, like,
thinking of...
yeah, it's got a couple of scales for them, the trumpets and the violins. I did it. You know, because it's, I don't know, I'm sentimental, I guess. We were doing, it was really neat, though, because we were at an Electric Lady studio, and it was like, I think it was September 18th, and Alan Lanier, who's in Blue Oyster Cult, played the guitars on it, and all of a sudden, like, we all got hit with some kind of strange sensation. We were cutting it, and all of a sudden I looked, and he was, like, on his knees, playing a solo, and then I looked down at Guitar Player magazine, and it had the dates, you know, Jimi Hendrix such and such to September 18th, and that was the night he died, you know, so it was real fitting that we did it that day, even unplanned, in a studio, on one's knees playing guitar.
Rock expressed male adolescent sexuality. The electrified guitar, microphone projected voice and body of the performer become phallic symbols. Rock wanted to overturn the generational power hierarchy which was ensured in the Oedipus complex. But there was a paradox. This left no part for the female.
I'd be happy if you'd give me something like, well, like your brother's given me, something honest and human and good. Don't be angry, son. If you want to give me a present, give me a good life. That's something I could value. Cow.
Just call me Angel of the Morning, Angel. Just touch my cheek before you leave me, baby. Just call me Angel of the Morning, Angel. Then slowly turn away from me.
As soon as I took my guitar in my hands, I realized it was what I'd been looking for.
A snake
was pale gold, glazed and shrunken. We were afraid to touch it.
Rock performances electrically unleash anarchic energies and provide a hypnotic, ritualistic trance basis for the mass audience, especially when both musicians and audience are under the influence of psychedelic drugs. Such shows suggest the transport of the tent meeting or the Shakers' deliberate seeking out of the devil in order to purify themselves and ensure a communion with God. Hippies advocate love as a magic elixir which will unite both heaven and hell. They don't distinguish between love and sex, as both challenge family definitions of son, daughter, mother, father. Love as sentimental romanticism must be replaced with a more open, universal form.
Future's yours.
Living together as tribal families, traveling in outfitted buses, occasionally camping out like the old Indian tribes in tents, hippies dream of a world before or after cities.
Go to the country, take the dog. Look at the sky without the smog. See the world, laugh at the farmers feeding hogs. Keep up, dogs. What a pity that the people from the city
policy.
I've been falling a lot lately. Look at this one.
Wow! What did this have? As a matter of fact, there's already a doctor over there, but the chick's having a baby. She's having a...
A piece of music that's just a pure expression of joy. Pure, like a celebration of existence, you know, like the coming of spring, or the sun rising, or something like that. Just pure, unbounded joy. You know, I don't think we've really done that yet.
There's a lackluster holes. There's a hole in Johnny's hair. Presses it, presses the hole in his skull, lays down in his sperm coffin. Oh, it's a place where he's been quite often. The people look at him and say, don't you have nothing but surrender? He gets up, takes off his leather jacket, take to his chest, there's pin knives in, jack knives in, switchblades first. Switchblades preferred. He cries, he screams, says life is filled with pain. I push it through my brain, then I fill my nose with snow. And a go rainbow, go rainbow, go rainbow. Oh, go Johnny, go and do the what you see. Do the what you see. There's a little place. It's a place called space. It's a pretty little place. It's a bronze track, calls a track. And the name of that place is...
Mother and father, grandmother and grandfather were driving through the desert at dawn, and a truckload of Indian workers had either hit another car or just, I don't know what happened, but there were Indians scattered all over the highway, bleeding to death. So the car pulls up and stops. That was the first time I tasted fear. I must have been about four, like a child, it's like a flower. His head is just floating in the breeze, man. The reaction I get now, thinking back, looking back, is that the souls and the ghosts of those dead Indians, maybe one or two of them, were just running around, freaking out, and just leaped into my soul. Indian, Indian, what did you die for? Indian says nothing at all. Gently they stir, gently rise, the dead or newborn awakening, with ravaged limbs and wet souls, gently they sigh.
But I won't be smiling, it's so far. Because,
somebody's hurt.
Even though the male rock star had absorbed the female seductive techniques of narcissism and coquettishness, his powers ultimately rested on his phallic presence.
Her father watched the Rolling Stones on TV, he screamed at them, but she was turned on, having her first orgasm. She identified with their non-Oedipal sexuality, saying, a girl would feel power, a guy could reveal his feminine side. As an adolescent, she became pregnant. She despised what it did to her body.
Yes, stand again. This electric whirlwind, this rushes of my knees like flame, and I feel like just some misplaced Joan of Arc in the cause as you looking up at me. Oh, baby, I remember when you were born. It was dawn in the storm. Settled in my belly, in the road, in the grass, in the spit of the gas, in the lit a match, in the void wind, flash in the sky, split.
The hall was overstuffed with people because the promoter had sold a few thousand extra seats, and went down to the stage. It was real hot. The stage was very shaky. We started, Jim didn't want to sing, we stopped, we started again. Jim started rapping to the audience.
It was a rap that he had done earlier in the studio one night when he was just screwing around in the studio. It was called Rock is Dead, and it was about the death of rock and roll, and that people, symbolically anyway, people expected just to see a freak show instead of hear some good rock and roll.
What did you come here for? You didn't come here to hear music. You didn't come here to see a good rock and roll band play some songs. You came here for something you've never seen before, something greater and bigger than you've ever experienced. What can I do, man? How about this? How about if I show you my... How about if I let you see it, man? Isn't that what you want? How about this? So he takes his shirt off, man, and he puts his shirt in front of himself. And he starts kind of dancing around, holding his shirt down, covering his groin, covering his crotch, man.
Americans recognize the fact that we have a lot of violence inherent in us. You know, it's like part of our culture. You know, it's part of our art, the 50s, you know, the great artists like Pollock and de Kooning, and that we should, like, work now that wars are over to not be ashamed to put violence in our art. You know, I have a lot of violence in art, in my art.
She rejects the simplicities of the false Arcadia of the 60s in favor of the reality of an ambiguity of urban violence in the 70s. She also accepts that rock and violence must coexist. This is the first manifestation of punk rock.
Forget all that stuff. You got me here. What do you want to do? Forget
well, the thing I'd like to talk about, what we're about here is we're doing 26 hours of alternative radio in the sense that...
Yeah, but how alternative is this radio?
Well, we've been having
I'll tell you how alternative this radio is. The first thing you tell me when I walk in is that you don't have a bleep machine and that to watch, you know, watch what I say. That's not alternative. That's the same old stuff, you know.
Well,
and you can notice that I said stuff being very, being completely professional at this moment. But we have a total alternative to, like, your alternative radio. It's the radio that I represent. Like right now, it's like we're out like outer space people. We're just gonna come in, we're gonna zoom like a leech, like come in like right on a hand, take over NEW right now. This is Radio Ethiopia. Rock and roll is becoming a bigger and bigger factor, and a bigger function, and a bigger freedom, a bigger lung all over the world than it ever was before. Rock and roll is being taken over by the people again.
During the performance of Ain't It Strange, Patty, whirling on stage, tripped over a piece of cable. She landed on her head on the cement floor 12 feet below. Taken to a hospital, x-rays discovered broken vertebra. She was placed in a neck cast. She was in severe pain for months. There was a temporary paralysis. 3 months later, Patty gave her first performance after the fall.
American Protestantism, just the opposite of Spanish Catholicism. Thanks for coming. And technically, we did a very good job, I think.
Yeah. Bueno, pues eso, muchas gracias a todos. Muchas gracias de nuevo a Adam por compartir con nosotros este vídeo y estos conocimientos sobre arte. Y sobre todo, os recuerdo que la semana que viene, miércoles, jueves y viernes, tenemos el seminario de Kaya Silverman titulado Carne de mi carne, y en el que, bueno, alguno de vosotros que no haya resultado exhausto después de hoy, pues os esperamos aquí. Muchas gracias otra vez.